How do you balance the desire for consistency, which makes programming easier, with the need for availability? Because imagine that your program is completing a shopping transaction on Amazon, and some piece of data that you need to update is inaccessible. What if Amazon blocked and said, come back after Christmas to complete your purchase? This is not acceptable. So you want to have the best balance between consistency, between availability, and you want to do this while taking into account the reality that when you have many locations, some of them may not be reachable at any given point in time, right? So the CAP theorem basically says design your systems, recognizing that you may have to trade off between these properties, right? On a more technical level, why is this important today? Historically, the notion of consistency, probably best seen in early database systems, where there was no distribution. There was a single location where all your data existed. However, for performance reasons, you wanted to take many different users' programs and interleave them. And when you do this, even though the programs are being executed with some interleaving, it gets very confusing when all of a sudden you see the effects of someone else's changes and you don't even know they're supposed to be there. So the idea of ACID transactions was, yes, you can interleave, but you do so carefully so that any given programmer can pretend that their program is running all by itself, right? That notion of ACID consistency is with respect to the database as a whole and deals with the impact of interleaving many programs. But going from there, as you go into massively distributed systems, and today's cloud systems typically run on thousands of nodes, right? And even that is going to be dwarfed in the not so distant future, maybe even now, when you take into account mobile devices. Your phone probably has cached data, and the app that's running on your phone is looking at the copy of the cache data as well as a master copy that's residing somewhere else. And when you take the number of phones out there or the number of iPads or other tablet devices and think of each of them as a location, imagine how many more you have, right? And how often are you connected to the internet? You have to be able to deal with scenarios when you're disconnected. You still want to provide a reasonable result. So all of a sudden, there's been this enormous premium on being able to program effectively in environments where there are many copies of data, many locations, be they devices or storage locations. And programming in this environment requires you to reason with what happens when some copy of the data you want is unavailable. In the distributed systems community, there are schemes like eventual consistency, where you don't synchronously update all the copies, but you do guarantee that if the system quiesces, meaning you stop making changes, eventually all copies will have all changes applied to them, right? This does open the possibility that when you read from a copy, it may not have the latest and greatest change, and you need to be able to program against this possibility. In the system that, and eventual consistency is implemented, for example, in the DNS system, domain name servers, or Amazon's Dynamo platform, so it's quite well known. Another example is what we call timeline consistency. There's essentially the notion that while you have multiple copies of an object, the changes go through a master, and every copy sees the same timeline of changes applied to it. From the point of view of the readers, this doesn't necessarily mean that every reader sees successively later versions. That'll happen if you insist upon reading from the master copy. But you could choose to read from a local copy. For example, if you want quick access, and it's okay to have a slightly stale copy, right? And in the distributed systems community, there have been various proposals. For example, monotonic reads, where regardless of how the copies are managed, from the standpoint of a reader, once I read a value, once I read a version of an object, I'm guaranteed never to see an older version. So people have been thinking about this problem for a long, long time. Today, a wide range of Yahoo applications, including search, the front page of Yahoo, mail, all in all, over 450, 500 applications at last count, rely upon peanuts to store their state in the background. The total amount of data in there, in the petabytes, the number of records in the hundreds of billions, the number of requests per second in the hundreds of thousands per second, and all this, you know, the sun never sets on the Yahoo empire. It's replicated across dozens of data centers worldwide. So peanuts is a simplified record store. So what do I mean by that? Like a SQL database, it gives you the abstraction of a table of records. It also gives you things like indexes. You can build multiple secondary indexes. The records themselves can be organized physically by sorting on a key or by hashing on a key. Thus far, very much like you would see from a conventional relational database. Here's where it gets to be interesting. It's designed to scale to thousands of nodes. And in particular, copies of a record are replicated at multiple nodes for high availability. Every record, not at the table granularity, every individual record in a table is managed as an independent domain of consistency. So effectively, there is a master for each copy, for each record. Changes are applied at the master, and the copies can be anywhere. The changes are asynchronously propagated to the copies. This is within the order of a few seconds, right? Records can be selectively replicated. Within a given table, some records may be in Shanghai and Singapore, but not in Sunnyvale. Others may be in Sunnyvale and Singapore, but not in Tokyo. Okay, and you can set policies to control all of this. Think about your user profile. Right? When you make your change to the user profile, it's typically you making a change. Right? On the other hand, many of your friends will probably be looking at it. So the master copy of your profile should be close to where you are. And let's say you live in Michigan, then your master profile record will probably be located on a server that's close by. You make changes, they're applied to this master copy, and your friends in California or wherever else may well be reading a slightly stale version of your profile that's in a copy closer to them. If you make a change, you don't pay the performance penalty of distribution because a local copy is being updated. And your friends see the changes within seconds. Right? But now what happens if you move to New York? Right? Now when you start making changes, if your copy, if your master copy continues to be in Michigan, there's a long round trip every time you want to modify the record. Peanuts can detect the fact that the requests are originating at a different colo, right? At a different colocation or a data center. When this happens, after a few such attempts, it will automatically transfer mastership to a copy that's closer to where you now are. So in this case, it might be a data center in the New York area. And any future changes you make will be applied there, right, and replicated elsewhere. So the notion of where your change is primarily applied is a logical one, and the system automatically detects where you're modifying an object from most often and moves the location around. If you think about the cap theorem, most people think of it as something that applies when the system is disconnected. The reality is you also have to take into account latency. If you take the peanuts example, let's say the system is fully connected. There's no failures. Still, when changes are made, recognizing that copies are distributed worldwide, you cannot realistically do, for example, a quorum protocol where you update a majority of the objects worldwide. It would just take too long. You just want to update a local copy and be done with it, right? And the master copy protocol of peanuts is optimized to allow for this. That and the combination of moving the master copy closer to you gives us this performance we seek. And then for increased read throughput, what we do is to take that and asynchronously make multiple copies, and reads that don't care about having the very latest copy can easily read off these other copies, right? And these other copies also allow us to deal with failure. And that's the rest of the story.